Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Millionaire Dentist Podcast, brought to you by Four Quadrants Advisory. On this podcast, we break down the world of dentistry finances and business practices to help you become the millionaire dentist you deserve to be. Please be advised, we do speak with an honest tongue and may not be safe for work.
Hello and welcome. This is Casey Hires back at the Millionaire Dentist Podcast in studio with co-host Jarrod Bridgman.
Hey, what's up?
And special reoccurring guest, the one and only Steve Levy, a.k.a. Pipes.
Hello there.
And he's been resting his pipes this season. He's so in demand in so many areas of life, especially in all things accounting, that he's your performances aren't you're taking a little hiatus?
A bit, but I'll be back for him.
I like it. Well, we wanted to bring you in for kind of a year-end roundup, if you will, for our listeners. What's important? What should they keep in mind?
I like wrap up better.
You like what?
Wrap up. Except roundup.
All right. Year-end wrap up. Jarrod, nice cardigan.
Thank you. I bought it myself. Listen here. So I reached out to Steve and I was like, Steve, you're the tax man. As in, you know a lot about taxes, not so much you go around collecting them. You're not, you know.
No, Sheriff, I'm the good guy.
You're not Sheriff Nottingham. So I wanted to talk to you a little bit about holiday bonuses and how does that work with reporting?
Well, we've got a lot of practices paying holiday bonuses, whether it be gift cards or checks or whatnot. Now, there's no such thing really as a gift to your employees. It's really, it's compensation to them because of the employer-employee relationship. And so because of that, those holiday bonuses need to be reported on their payroll.
Whoa. What's wrong with just putting some cash in an envelope and handing it out?
Well, that is not an uninterested gift. It is really...
It's an interesting gift.
It's an interesting gift.
I'd like it.
But the problem is you're their employer and you're essentially still kind of paying them for providing the services.
Greedy Uncle Sam wants his cut. Let's cut the shit.
That's correct.
Does this count for like gift cards as well?
Gift cards as well.
And what about something like an object? Like a purchased gift.
Wine or really within the IRS's mind, there's no true gift to your employee. So it would need to be reported on payroll. Now,
Can I fire you first and then give you like a really nice present?
Then the relationship does kind of stop. Right. So you got a point there.
There might be legal ramifications, which that's your other expertise.
Yeah. But it is compensation. So those that are paying these should let your payroll provider know so that it does get included on their W-2 for the year.
I do want to ask you this. Does it take effect to when the gift is given or when the gift was, let's say, purchased? Because sometimes some places may have their holiday party early January, for example.
It's really when it's given because that's sort of the payment to the employee. So while it might be an expense earlier, the actual payment is when the compensation is given. So it's something to watch out for. It's something that needs to be done.
How about if you're in Orange County, California, and you do like a 3-hour like yacht party, Christmas party, cruise, you have it catered, you've got a bartender, it's just gorgeous, and you know maybe you spend $25,000 on this. How does that come into like a holiday party tax? How's that treated?
Well, holiday party is kind of a carve-out for a lot of rules in that... For entertainment expenses, those can't be deducted except for the holiday party. So if you're talking about the yacht and everything, and you're bringing some cool artists.
A large vessel.
Large vessel.
80 to 90 feet.
Okay. Okay, I'll run with that.
And some call it a boat, some call it a yacht.
Yeah. It's kind of that the bot. Or I don't know. So entertainment expenses, meal expenses, those are all slam dunk, 100% deductible. So if you want to go for it.
So if you spend $20K on a holiday party, how much can you deduct?
$20K.
Oh, it's 100% deductible.
100%.
Hmm.
Might throw some holiday party soon.
When should a business owner, practice owner maybe say, huh, I need to have an extra big one, an extra expensive one, because that would help me? Does that tie into Section 179 where it's not a good tax strategy to just blow money?
Yeah, I would say, you know, you'd kind of want to see, maybe consult your accountant to see what your tax situation might look like and see what kind of real benefit you're going to get out of it. Obviously, there's a huge benefit to company morale, but you'd still want to see if it's going to really
benefit. As long
as
there's no career limiting actions that occur at said party.
Yeah, you don't want those CLMs are killer.
Have you seen Office Christmas Party with Jason Bateman?
Yes.
No.
Oh my gosh. If you're a Christmas movie freak, but you're kind of getting tired of the run-of-the-mill ones, why him is a suggestion, James Franco. But Office Christmas Party, talk about some career-limiting moves. Amazing. That's just my public service announcement. Right. So you can deduct your holiday party.
You certainly can. 100%. It's the carve-out for not being able to deduct entertainment expenses.
Let me ask you, in terms of the holiday party, is there a time frame in which the party must happen?
No, really. It's it doesn't just have to be a holiday party. It can be any company party.
But you can only do one.
No, not necessarily that either. As long as it kind of falls within that it's a gathering with your employees and having a big party, whatever entertainment, maybe like a summer sort of event, you can certainly do that as well.
And then Casey kind of brought up the end of year purchases and how people may think it's a good idea to, let's just buy some things now so we can try and write it off.
Yeah.
And you said that's not always a good idea.
Yeah, it really isn't. You're trying to chase taxes with purchases that, and a lot of vendors are coming for you and saying, hey, get that tax write-off.
Can I share a story?
Yes, please.
We look at a lot of information, a lot of data, and we were talking to somebody who they may be ripe for a $125,000 tax surprise. We looked at their data for, an hour and figured out some of these things. And that was the first they were hearing of it. Thus probably why they were engaged in our vetting process to change. But literally word for word was, you might want to go out and make some business purchases, and acted like the onus was on them to correct this $125,000 tax additional bill that wasn't accounted for because the standard of care at this accounting firm was crap, which is most of the time that we see.
Wow. That is...
Is that unreal. What you're talking about?
That's what I'm talking about. Just spend money. You'll get deductions, really like 30% or so, but spend it. You don't need it, but go ahead and shell out money for that tax deduction. Yeah.
Does that make you sad or does it piss you off? Because I feel both emotions.
Really both, because it's just people being their own accountant saying that just disgusts me. I can't handle that. So
should we have like a cage fight, you versus other accountants?
Yes, let's do it.
All right.
A sing
Set
off.
It up.
Let's do a sing off. Yeah.
Well, and we've mentioned that Section 179 deduction before. And again, unless, when industry comes knocking as a suggestion to buy some equipment at the end of the year, unless they have your full tax picture, they have no right giving you advice on what to buy for a tax reason. Accurate?
Absolutely.
Now, when a tax firm or a CPA firm who actually has just a bunch of EAs doing the work, not actual CPAs, public service announcement, check that. Just because a CPA owns the firm who's actually doing your taxes, we're seeing a lot of EAs on those taxes, enrolled agents, which is a massive red flag. But ultimately, if they're looking at your full tax situation, they haven't done a good job with your taxes and there's a discrepancy at the end of the year that's large, what a lazy way for them to just, hey, go buy some stuff.
Yeah, it's
lazy.
Lazy and borderline unethical right there. So, yeah.
Well, I guess if your CPA is married to a rep who sells equipment, that's very unethical.
Very much so.
What we're talking about, it's a gray area, but it's certainly terrible professionally and like to try to be good at something. In accounting, that's just a terrible standard.
Yeah, it really is.
Steve, with the new year coming up, there's oftentimes changes in terms of taxes and tax brackets and things like that. Is there anything like that we need to know for 2023?
Yeah, one particular one, you mentioned tax brackets. There is some good news on the horizon there. I'll step back. The federal tax system and some state tax systems are based on graduated tax rates, which means that there's a certain amount that are taxed at a certain rate. And then as you go higher, typically, that income, as you go higher, gets taxed at a higher rate. And so, so for instance, if you're married filing joint, you're up to $89,000 is taxed at 12%. That's sort of kind of how the graduated tax rates go. Now, the good news for 2023 is that there is more taxable income pushed to the lower rates than ever before. And that's based on cost of living adjustments. And so, for instance,
so if you're making, let's say, the same amount this year as you were last year, and you're maybe right on that threshold,
yeah,
you could be getting taxed for less.
That's right. Your overall tax bill might be less because more of your taxable income is being pushed to the lower bracket.
Got it.
And so that's it, and to the tune of $30,000 to $40,000. So that's not small change there at all.
What's your favorite cola?
Favorite cola? I'm going RC, actually.
Whoa.
Right?
That's old school.
I know.
I mean, cherry RC is pretty
good. No, no tab.
Now we're really hitting it hard.
Jocasta?
You put something on this post-it that I'm looking at that says 2023 401k cola increase.
That's
what's
correct.
A 401k cola? Is that a
I'd like to know what cola means, because I don't, from a tax perspective or a 401k perspective.
Cost of living adjustment.
Oh, look at the big brains on this guy.
That took me way too long. In fact, I'd be told that's how long it took.
So speaking of 401k, big changes there as well, to the tune of $2,000 more that you can defer for your 401k and your catch up if you're 50 or older goes from $6,500 to $7,500. So there's some pretty significant jumps. It usually nominally jumps maybe 500 or so, but we're talking 2000 for the deferral and 1000 for the catch up.
What's the so adding 2000, what does that put us to?
Well, we're at 22,500 for the total you can defer for 2023, and we're looking at 7500 for the catch up contribution if you're 50 or over. So we're looking at a solid 30K overall.
Wow.
Not bad. There's also a big increase in the amount that can be considered as compensation for the match. Usually, not all of your compensation can be considered for a match, like for, say, like 4% or whatever your match is. That boosted up from $305,000 in 2022 to $330,000 in 2023. So the match can be really up to 4% of that.
And by match, you mean whatever the company's matching.
Correct.
You just said 305 to 330.
That's right.
Woo.
Yeah.
It was just 285 a few years ago.
Right. It's jumping super fast. Another cola adjustment.
Ooh. Yes. I like what you did there, Mr. RC. Steve, thanks for coming in and sitting down with us at the end of year. Just to, again, give our listeners some things to think about, maybe a list if they don't work with us to ask their CPAs. Unfortunately, a lot of things do slip through the cracks, especially for practice owners. It's not, you don't have a normal tax situation. It is unique. It is specialized. Unfortunately, most don't have a specialized team. And so unfortunately, you need to be aware of these things and potentially be asking the right questions.
Yes, please do.
And you know, what's crazy is if you're not for sure what's really going on with your numbers that way, we are offering a complimentary assessment on fourquadrantsadvisory.com/assessment. It is free. You can sign up and you can pick one of the eight topics we have listed. So check that out. Also, we will be on the road in January and February at various places. So visit fourquadrantsadvisory.com/events. Check us out. A lot of free events at Topgolf, where you can swing a club, have some food, have a couple drinks, and talk with Casey, which is amazing.
We have people swing clubs and heels. You don't have to be good at golf.
Yeah.
Thanks, guys. Thanks, Steve. Merry Christmas.
You too.
Merry Christmas.
That's all the time we have today. Thank you to our guests for their insight and for sharing some really great information. And thank you to you, the listener, for tuning in. The Millionaire Dentist Podcast is brought to you by Four Quadrants Advisory. To see if they might be a good fit for you and your practice, go on over to fourquadrantsadvisory.com and see why year after year, they retain over 95% of their clients. Thank you again for joining us, and we'll see you next time.